to welcome to Lexington, Kentucky for prime time in the SEC. 21st-ranked Tennessee is looking to respond after last week's loss to Alabama. Joe Milton and company again on the road, and today in a border battle with longtime foe Kentucky. The Cats like the Vols, trying to keep a season on the tracks. Welcome to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. A couple of 5-2 teams in the SEC playing for the 80th consecutive season. Tennessee and Kentucky both facing a fork in the road today. With that, we say hello and thanks for joining us with Jesse Palmer and Katie George. I'm Mike Monaco, and a big hinge point for both teams tonight. And let's start with the Vols. They jumped out to a big lead on Alabama last week, but the tide roared back, and again, Tennessee on the road.
They're a team with a bad taste in their mouth, no doubt. Still have a chance at having a special season, but Mike, they've got to be able to handle this environment here. Playing on the road has been the problem. Both losses this year at Florida, at Alabama. In fact, they've lost four of their last five conference games on the road, so you got to deal with the crowd noise here at Kroger Field. You have to handle your emotions. It's going to be critical Tennessee starts fast and tries to seize some momentum early.
In this environment at Kroger Field, Mark Stoops and company started 5-0, coming off back-to-back losses, ready to go here in Lexington. And here come the Wildcats. Well, today we're going to see two of the elite rushing attacks in the country. And for Kentucky, Ray Davis has been one of the best backs in the land.
Maybe one of the biggest surprises in college football, too. Not a lot of people talking about him when he entered the portal, left Vandy, and came to Kentucky. But he has been a big play waiting to happen. He's got all the tools you look for in successful running backs. He's got vision. He can play off of the leverage of defenders when he gets in the second level and find the path of least resistance to get to the end zone. He can make people miss in the open field. He's got tremendous speed, but he's also elusive. Even when it looks like you got him hemmed in here, like Florida on the swing route, make a linebacker miss, you make the safety miss, and you run over the cornerback and get in the end zone. But when he gets in the open field, that's really what makes him special. I think Liam Cohen, their offensive coordinator, has been real creative in finding more creative ways to get him the ball in space, because when he does that, generally really good things happen for this Kentucky offense. And you look at his stats, this guy really has been the entire offense for Kentucky this year.
For more on Ray Davis, we go down to Katie George.
Well, guys, Ray Davis says this is the healthiest he's ever been in his five-year collegiate career, and that's a testament to his self-control. He's not a guy to skip reps. He's always willing to put his body on the line. But this spring, coaches told him it's about getting the horse to the race, being judicious with your reps. Davis said he had to prioritize rest and recovery over extra reps, and he said it was so worth it. He feels great. Heck, he said, I could play six quarters tonight if my team wanted me to, Mike.
Well, let's see how long we go. He is running the race tonight against fast-paced Tennessee here in Lexington. When we come back, Vols and Cats on the way. You're watching the SEC on ESPN. Tennessee won the toss and deferred to the second half, so Kentucky at home, out of a bye week, will receive the opening kickoff. Josh Turbeville to put it in the air with Barrion Brown back deep for the Wildcats. Well, Devin Leary is the sixth-year senior quarterback for Kentucky. NC State transfer, and they're hoping for the best from him.
Well, he's had a lot of struggles this year throwing the football, no question about that. And part of that is playing in a brand-new system offensively, but he's also needs to play better. He's missed a lot of throws. He's forced the ball into coverage, already thrown seven picks on the season, tied for most in the SEC. They have yet to get four good quarters in the same game from Devin Leary, and they're hoping to get that done today against the Tennessee defense that loves to blitz and bring pressure.
One of the best in the country in that regard for defensive coordinator Tim Banks. Back-to-back losses, then the bye week for Kentucky. And Devin Leary at the controls. Ray Davis on the ground and nothing there to start out. Well, different offensive line for Kentucky. Remember last time out against Missouri, they had got Kenneth Horsey back. Well, something came up in practice this week, so he's unavailable at left guard, but Jagger Burton does return.
Yeah, Dylan Bray, they're going to get him going at left guard. This will be his sixth start of the season, and Jagger Burton getting cleared for them in the back end is really, really big as well up front. This is an offensive line that wants to be able to push Tennessee around and try and give some space to Ray Davis.
On second down, here is O'Leary on one of those screens, and Berrion Brown probing for some space, and he's wrapped up. It's a loss of five.
And Amari Thomas, big defensive tackle, showing off his athleticism, 320 pounds. He actually got up and tipped this ball. Berrion Brown was lucky he was able to catch it. Berrion, you see there, Big O gets the big paws up, and Kentucky still comes up with the reception, but a loss. And now third and long, and this is a situation that Kentucky really wants to be able to avoid throughout the course of this game. Pass protection has not been great, especially in their last two games. And we mentioned Tennessee in third down. They can bring pressure, get the edge. They've got a lot of speed.
Three down front for the Vols. Play clock winding down on Leary. They bring four. Leary rolls and takes off with his legs. And he's wrapped up just short of the line to gain.
It was a real good decision by Devin Leary there to take off. He had nothing open, decided to try to go get it himself. Really nice pursuit, though, and speed by Tennessee at the linebacker spot. Caleb Perry able to get there for a tackle. Head coach Mark Stoops not feeling good enough this early, fourth and one, deep in his own territory to go for it.
Yeah, they haven't gone for it a lot this year, only four times on fourth down.
D. Williams back there to return for Tennessee, one of the best in the business, third in the nation, averaging 17 yards a return.
Ready to get it from Wilson Berry, the redshirt sophomore from Australia who struggled last time out against Missouri. High kick and a fair catch from Williams at the 30. All right, flip side. Leary, a veteran on one side. Joe Milton on the other at the controls for Tennessee.
Yeah, and Joe Milton has been a bit inconsistent himself this year. Look, there's times he looks like a top 10 pick. 6'5", he's got the best arm in all of college football, and it just jumps off the screen at you, but his downfield accuracy remains a big question mark. Joe Milton has missed a lot of touchdown passes this year. Because of that, the offense really has never been able to get in gear the way it did a year ago. Certainly in this game, they feel like they're going to get their opportunity to take some shots deep down the field. When those shots present themselves, Mike, Joe Milton's got to hit.
Yeah, last year, of course, 46 points per game for Tennessee, the best offense in the country for the Vols. Great rushing attack, and they start out with Jalen Wright, one of three backs we will see. And fast pace for Tennessee.
Fast pace for Tennessee, not so much for Kentucky. Two different trains of thought here with respect to how they attack it offensively. In the 3 years Josh Heupel's been at Tennessee, they're averaging almost three plays a minute. Kentucky, though, they want to go slow.
Throw to the outside, and that's Dante Fulton, the Oregon transfer. We're going to see more on the outside in this one, third down and short.
Which I think is a good place for him, too. 6'5", 214 pounds with lots of speed. And we talked about them wanting to take shots for Josh Heupel in this offense. He's a guy that I think is going to get his opportunities in this game to use that speed in the framework.
First catch for Dante Fulton in more than a month. And now third down and two. Milton will run it. And he did this a lot against Alabama. You want to see more of it.
I think they need to do this more. At 6'5 and 240 pounds, man, he is a load. And he can be a big weapon in this offense carrying it. I know he's not Cam Newton. He's not Lamar Jackson. He's not that dynamic. But when you gain an extra blocker by letting Milton run it, the numbers even up. In those short yardage situations where they've struggled, then all of a sudden, good things can happen.
Looks left and throws to the sideline, and that's Squirrel White coming off his biggest game of the season against Bama.
He's got a lot of speed, and you're going to see them line Squirrel White up all over the field in the slot. They'll hide him at the H spot, put him outside. If they get a one-on-one chance for a guy that's been clocked at 23.4 miles per hour, they're going to take that chance.
Expect to see a lot of Drew Phillips, 23 in blue, with White today. Second down and three, and Jalen Wright slips a tackle. Jalen Wright is up to the races and gone. 52 yards.
This is just a classic pin-pull recipe right here. Down block, Ollie Lane going to come up, and he's going to get Jackson at linebacker. It opens up the crease. And for Jalen Wright, he has the ability to make safeties miss. And when you can do that, you can hit the home run. He has been sensational for Tennessee's offense. And here's the thing, Mike. They've got two other good ones, too. This rushing attack for Tennessee has been a problem for defenses to stop.
It's been one of the best, as we told you, in the country, much like Kentucky. But it's Jalen Wright who they start with, who gets the balls going on the road in Lexington from 52 yards out. Wright for six. Jalen Wright last week against Alabama, 11 carries for 22 yards. Well, rips off a big one, and the Vols with that big play attack that Kentucky saw a lot of in the meeting last season has the lead on the road. Josh Turbeville in the air and a touchback.
You know, Mike, early in Jalen Wright's career, he was against gaining weight. He was a track star, one of the fastest 60-meter sprinters in the country coming out of high school. So his speed was his strength. He didn't want to lose that by gaining weight. But he realized when he went from 188 pounds last season to 215, he's not any slower. Joey Halsley says you can see the difference in his run style. He's no longer bouncing off everything. He's delivering blows. Halsley said Wright went from being a fast kid you're handing the ball to a running back, a well-rounded guy.
Yeah, Katie, he's gotten so much better at running between the tackles, too, because of that physical style. You're right. He is the complete back now.
Second possession for Kentucky after three and out the first time, and it's a completion to Demi Sumo-Cardme, running back slash wide receiver for 4 yards.
He's a bit of a Swiss Army knife in this offense, and he's a guy that can play running back or play wide receiver, but whenever he's gotten opportunities in games, good things tend to happen. And I think if you're the offensive coordinator, Liam Cohen, you're trying to find more ways to get this guy involved. You're going to see him line up all over the field.
Yeah, we asked Liam Cohen out of the bye week, who is that guy? You got to get more touches, and he didn't hesitate. He said zero. Second down and six from the 29, and the second carry for Ray Davis pushes the pile, and he brings up third down and manageable.
Yeah, it's an offensive line, the big blue wall at Kentucky, that is a much better run blocking unit than they are pass protecting unit. They've got big bodies, and they like to lean on you, wear you down over the course of four quarters. We saw that when they ran for nearly 330 yards against the Florida Gators. It's going to be critical. You get a short completion on first down, nice run here. You keep these third downs manageable like this versus what happened on their first drive.
When it was third down and 15 for Devin Leary at Kentucky. Under center and on third and one, does not get a push. No gain, and it's fourth down.
Yeah, and I don't love the call. You got Ray Davis behind you, the SEC's leading rusher. Just turn around and hand it off. That time, Tyler Barron at defensive end just caved in on Brendan Bates, the tight end. You're going to see him at the bottom of the screen, number nine. She's able to get that penetration, and there's just too many white jerseys. That's a huge missed opportunity for Kentucky that looks like they're going for it here.
How do you feel about that from the 34?
Yeah, I think you're trying to get, well, you didn't do it on the first drive, then you watch Tennessee just march down the field and score. I don't know if that's, you know, a message for Mark Stoops not believing in his defense because of the struggles the last couple weeks. This shows me that you're putting a lot of faith in number one.
Told you they don't do this a lot, and on fourth down, Davis leaning forward. Davis. And appears to be short.
And it was Barron again. The same guy that made the play on the quarterback sneak. This time he's able to beat the left tackle, Marcus Cox, one-on-one and make a play.
He didn't get there. Turnover on downs.
Tyler Barron with back-to-back monster stops in short yardage situation. Here he is right here, and you're just going to see at the point of attack, just too physical up front. That time he's working against the left guard, Dylan Ray. And just nowhere for Ray Davis to go. And we talked about how Tennessee had to come out in this game on the road where they struggled. They had to start fast. They score a touchdown in the opening drive for the sixth time this season. And now because the defense gets a massive stop, Joe Milton, this offense cooking here, about the 34-yard line.
Barron, one of the many defensive linemen you really like for the Vols. He steps up.
Very athletic and kind of known as a pass rusher with 5 sacks this year, but making 2 huge plays against the run.
Short field, sudden change. Midway through the first. And here's running back number 2, Jabari Small, out of the backfield. And a good gain on first down.
Yeah, when you're playing in a tempo offense like this, everybody's got to touch it at running back. So it's the law firm of Wright, Small, and Sampson, right? And they kind of divide it 40-30-30, and then the second half start to ride the hot hand a little bit more.
Jalen Wright seated. And it's Small again, left side, and he's got a first down.
There's a big challenge for Kentucky's front seven here, front six, to slow the running game down with only 6 guys in the box. When you think about Tennessee's losses, Florida and Alabama, those defenses were able to do it, but you got to leave DBs out to protect the shot plays in the air.
7th best rushing attack in the country in yards per game, and you love the defensive line as well for Kentucky. Derrick Jackson in on the stop on another small carry for 2. Brad White, the coordinator of this Kentucky defense, in his 5th year in the role. Second down at 8, and it's Small up the middle. Inside the 20, and red zone efficiency is big for Tennessee as well.
It is, and here's another situation, this down and distance, where Joe Milton's legs can be a factor, whether it's a designed run or if things aren't open and he wants to go take off. He's athletic to get that done. I love the fact that he carried it 15 times last week against Alabama. You're craving that every week you watch them play. This is an area of the field, though, where that could really be a force for this offense.
Third down from the 18. Milton flushed. Rolls out with a couple of flags down, and he will tuck it. He's got a first down, and we will check the 2 markers that appeared to be holding.
Yeah, I'm thinking John Campbell, the Miami transfer at left tackle, looked like he hooked Keyshawn Silver that time.
Holding. Offense number 74. 10-yard penalty.
And you saw Andre Carrick rotates in at left guard, down on the play for the Vols.
And that's a guy who's had some injury problems this year, too. He's already missed 3 games with an upper body injury. There's the hold up top on John Campbell, and that's an easy call to make. But Tennessee on the offensive line right now, a little bit banged up.
We'll check on Carrick when we come back to Lexington.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. 18 hotel brands, 1 loyalty program. Download the app. And in part by Ford. Build Ford proud.
119th meeting in this border battle. Peyton Manning in 97. 5 touchdown passes here in Lexington. And now Joe Milton and the Vols staring down 3rd down in the red zone. And Josh Heupel said to us yesterday, the number one thing that's got to improve, red zone offense. He said it's been a little bit of everything. We've had penalties. We've had inefficiency throwing it down here as well.
Well, the windows are smaller down in this area of the field. That's why generally the best red zone offenses are the ones that run it the best. But this obviously a passing situation. Joe Milton's got to be very good and careful with his decision making here.
Ollie Lane takes over at left guard. For the Vols. 3-man rush, and they flip it to Jalen Wright, and just a yard brings up 4th and long.
Big Deion Walker. I think he's the best NFL prospect on this Kentucky football team. 6'6", 350 pounds. He's so quick. He's like a big cat. It's amazing how well this guy's able to move a guy his size. He's been doing this all year. He doesn't make the tackle, but he makes the play there on a shovel pass. Missouri found out the hard way last week. He had 4 tackles for loss in that game. This guy is a monster.
So it sets up Charles Campbell from 44. The 24-year-old Indiana transfer, 11 for 13 this season, looking for his longest of the year. And Campbell is good, and the lead is 10 for Tennessee. Well, on the Kentucky defense elsewhere, how about Maxwell Hairston? 5 interceptions this year, tied for the national lead. Midseason All-American, of course, had the 2 pick sixes against Vanderbilt. Already the most INTs by a Wildcat since 2009. And he was kind enough to go all access. He was mic'd up pregame.
Nah,
you should be good.
How's it feel?
It feel good.
Okay, good.
It's a good vibe right here. Let's get it, brother.
It's one of them days.
These boys wearing orange. Nah, they finna wear blue after the game. You already know we on, boy.
On me?
You already know we on.
Oh. Yeah, ain't it?
No cap. This is a money game right here. It's gonna be a good one. My dog, appreciate you.
Ball out, bro.
Appreciate you.
Noting the orange and white that's here and saying that this is a money game.
It is a money game, no doubt. You could argue he's the MVP of this defense this year. You see the 5 picks tied for most in the nation. Also leads the defense in tackles, but down 10-0, they could use some turnovers. They could use a big game from Harrison.
2-score deficit for Kentucky with 5:34 to go here in the first.
Yeah, and I think for Kentucky it's important now to come out and establish a little bit of a rhythm and stay on the field. Their defense has already played a lot of snaps at a very, very fast tempo. They've got to keep Joe Milton and those weapons on the sideline and generate a few first drives here and get some momentum of their own going, get the crowd back in this thing.
This Kentucky team coming off a loss against Missouri, 38-21, where, like Tennessee last week, up early in that game, up 14-0 in the first, but Missouri's fake punt really changed the course of that game. Play action for Devin Leary. Plants, fires downfield, and he's got his man. Out toward midfield, and it's Jordan Dingle, one of his tight ends.
Really nice job. Jordan Dingle had a lot of traffic that he had to navigate through the middle of the field running that deep crossing route. And nice job by Leary there, staying with it, allowing the window to open up, and then delivering a very accurate ball deep down the field. That's a lot of stuff, a lot of junk to get through in between 4 white jerseys. But there's an explosive play to help generate some excitement for this offense.
All smiles for Dingle, 22 yards. First down, out past the 45. And now a flag on the far side of the field. They had a false start.
False start. Offense number 1. 5-yard penalty. First down.
They had taken Ray Davis that time. They were going to line him up out wide at wide receiver. And I think that, you know, formationally, that's an example of what Liam Cohen's trying to do here, is just to find ways to get him more touches, give the defense different looks. He can't touch it enough, whether it's running the football, screens. But as you see, penalties have been a massive problem for these two teams in particular in the conference.
Mark Stoops said to us, we've been frustrated, we've been undisciplined, and it's been a big problem.
Got another false start.
False start. Offense number 6. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
It's just hard to get any traction going.
It has to drive you crazy, too, if you're Mark Stoops, because penalties like that, it's not an effort problem. It's just attention to detail and mental focus early in a game. This is just a formation, getting lined up properly, breaking the huddle and going and executing a play. Those are the types of penalties, the pre-snap penalties like that, drive you absolutely nuts.
He's called them foolish. He said it's inexcusable. And it backs up the Cats into first down at 20. And a quick throw, and it's Demi Sumo-Kangbe with his second touch on first down.
Nice tackle by Aaron Beasley. He's been all over the place for this Tennessee defense. He's a guy who's very slippery, hard to block, but really good at making open field tackles and getting guys to the ground.
Fifth-year senior, third-year starter for the Vols defensively. It's a Tennessee defense, top 20 in the country in total defense, third best in the SEC. Berrion Brown in motion. Four-man rush, and Leary steps up. Stumbles forward, and he's out past the 50, ushered out by Beasley.
I'm all for it, too, man. For this offense to get it going, running the ball, it can't just be Ray Davis. You're going to see reverses to Berrion Brown. They're going to get Kangbe in the action as well. And when windows open up for Devin Leary, he's got to take those two. We saw it on the very first drive. But if you're Liam Cohen right there calling plays on offense, you're trying to get all hands on deck, everybody going.
And his return to Lexington, of course, last year with the Rams as their offensive coordinator. So you 0 for 2 on third downs for the Wildcats.
Third down, you got to focus on number 27 for Tennessee. James Pierce has been a monster this year with 7 sacks. Here he is lined up on the right tackle.
On Jeremy Flax. On third down, Leary is complete inside the 40, and it's Dingle again to move the sticks. 7 catches all year. He's got 2 on this drive. This time it's 16.
Well, that time Dylan Ray, the left guard, did a great job coming back and finding Pierce peeling around here on the twist, getting a block. That was the pass pro and the time that Devin Leary needed to complete that throw. Great job.
Davis trying to cut it back, and there is nothing there. Beasley in on another tackle.
You know, guys, during the bye week, Liam Cohen went back and rewatched some of Devin Leary's film from NC State. Cohen said he wanted to revisit what Leary does best. For example, Leary loves 4 vertical passes as a concept. He has a lot of confidence in that play. So Cohen is still trying to incorporate some of what Leary does well into his system so that they can find consistency offensively moving forward here.
I think it's a great idea, Katie, too. They had the bye week, so they had the extra time to do some self-scouting, but also some studying back at NC State just to try to find play calls and schemes and concepts that Leary's comfortable with.
Second down, there's a flag down, and Leary throws to the sideline, complete to Tavion Robinson. Check the marker.
Offside, defense number 19. Line of scrimmage is on the snap. 5-yard penalty. Replay second down.
You know, you got to think, though, as you're watching Devin Leary early in this game, it does look like he's in a pretty good rhythm, Mike. He's seeing the field. The ball's coming out on time when it needs to. And when guys aren't open, he's taking off and running. I know the coaching staff really felt like last week against Missouri, the first 3 quarters were the best 3 quarters he had played throwing. He had some turnover problems in the last period. But so far early in this one, from a rhythm standpoint, Devin Leary looking pretty good. 3 for 3 on this drive.
And 5 for 5 you saw overall. Coming up on the final minute of the first. Pressure, quick release, and a catch for Tavion Robinson. Down at the 11. Gabe Judy Lally makes the stop after 16.
And there's another good decision by Leary, throwing where the blitz comes from. It's coming right here. You're going to get a route right in behind it. It's the quick game. It comes out. His eyes go to it right away. And another example, Devin Leary dialed into this game plan.
2 years ago, he was so good at NC State, set records, broke records of Phillip Rivers. And then last year, the torn pec midway through the season with the Wolfpack. And now here in Lexington, and he's got the Wildcats in the red zone. Leary under pressure to the end zone and too tall. Wanted Dane Key.
That time, Leary took a big hit. James Pierce got in the backfield, but you know, I think for Leary right now, if you're Liam Cohen, because you're seeing how well he's progressing through everything, you keep dialing up these pass calls. Look at that. You get one on the side. You got Norman Lott, big D tackle, hitting you right in the chest. Not a lot of fun. This Tennessee defense, their pass rush is legit. They're averaging 4 sacks a game. They've got guys that can win up front one-on-one. We talk about the pressures that D coordinator Tim Banks likes to dial up.
Those 4 sacks a game, 4th most in the country. On second down, it is Davis. And he's been bottled up so far. Slipped the tackle and fights for maybe a couple of yards.
Yeah, I think right now, Tennessee up front, especially in the inside of that defensive line, those D tackles are winning. They're eating double teams. They're getting some pushback in the backfield. Nowhere for Ray Davis to go between attackers. And they're going to have to force him to try to throw it here if they're going to try to get a touchdown in the red zone.
Ray Davis, you saw, was shaking his head at the end of the first quarter in Lexington. Jalen Wright got it started for Tennessee, and after 15 minutes here at Kroger Field, balls up 10-0 with Kentucky driving. Next Saturday, SEC Network College Football Primetime with Kentucky taking on Mississippi State, 7:30 p.m. Eastern, over on SEC Network. Well, Kentucky off the mat after the penalties earlier on this drive, facing a big third down in the red zone.
Yeah, it's important, I feel like, in this one, too, to come away with 7 points based on what we've seen from Tennessee the first two drives and trying to keep this thing close. Obviously, you don't want this to turn into a track meet, but this is a big opportunity for this offense.
8 plays, 65 yards so far, and now third down and 9. And Leary to the sideline, incomplete, intended for Dingle, and it brings up fourth down.
Well, they wanted to try to throw it to Ray Davis, running the corner route out of the backfield. Tennessee's coverage in big zone took that throw away, so Leary went to the right place with the football. Even if he had caught it, it wasn't going to be a first down, but you're going to see Davis here work the corner. And this is an example of Cohen trying to find new ways to get him touches. He caught a pass similar to that against Missouri for a score early in that game, but got to give Tennessee's defense credit, playing well with their eyes, forcing a field goal try.
And now a 28-yard try for the Georgia Southern transfer, Alex Rayner. Hasn't attempted a field goal since September 30th, but he is good, and Kentucky is on the board. Drive down the field, get 3. The lead is 7 for the Vols in the second.
A presentation of the Southeastern Conference on ESPN. A new era of the SEC begins in 2024 on ESPN and ABC.
A couple of SEC teams at 5-2 here in Lexington, and one of your favorite holiday weekends, Jesse Palmer.
I'm a big fan, and I count Halloween as a holiday for sure. Living in New York City for 21 years, I can say with confidence, one of the great Halloween cities in the world.
Chance Board gets it away, and no chance for D. Williams. We check in for the first time with Matt Berry.
Gentlemen, good evening. Time now for your AT&T 5G studio update. Going to start with USC. They were down 2 scores late. Marshawn Lloyd here puts it in to tie it 43-all with Cal late fourth quarter. Also, Air Force. I can't verify this through research. I think this might be the first snow game of the year. Zach Lariota, Dane Kinnaman. Air Force up early 7-0.
All right, Matt, thanks very much.
You have a favorite costume from your past?
Mario, I would say.
Who got to for me.
Really?
Zoolander, yeah.
Just dying for me to ask you.
It was a winner.
Tennessee with it up by 7 early on in the second. And Joe Milton uncorks that cannon of an arm downfield and incomplete. He wanted Ramel Keaton.
And there's Maxwell Harrison. We've talked about how important and valuable he's been to this defense. And that time, one-on-one with one of Tennessee's best deep threats outside. He turns around. They're definitely locked up. But turning around and trying to locate the football is an indicator a lot of referees look for to not throw pass interference. I like the call.
On second down, here is Wright. So elusive. And he's got a first down before he's upended by Hairston.
This is what a lot of people that don't watch Tennessee don't know. This is not an air raid offense. They run the football 55% of the time, and they spread you out. They go up tempo. They're running against 6 in the box, and they break off explosive runs.
Here is Wright again with a big lane up the middle. In the plus territory as they keep it on the ground with Jalen Wright.
And they roll in new, fresh guys all the time, whether it's Wright, whether it's Small, whether it's Sampson, and they're putting up 217 rushing yards a game, tops in the SEC because of how physical this O-line is and how talented their backs are.
From the 46, Wright is met by Trevin Wallace, who missed the Missouri game with a reported shoulder injury, comes back.
Yeah, and he's a big get back for this defense as well. Because of his speed and his ability to go sideline to sideline, he's also a guy they love to blitz in obvious passing situations. Missing him against Missouri really hurt this defense, and they need him to play well in this game.
Pairs really well with De'Aaron Jackson, senior linebacker for the Wildcats. About as slow as you will see Tennessee go offensively.
Well, they had to give Kentucky an opportunity to substitute there. Tennessee had a substitution change, and Kentucky took their time, basically walking off the field.
And now a flag, and looks to be on Tennessee.
False start. Offense, number 76. 5-yard penalty. On second down.
An interesting cat-mouse game here between the coaching staff in terms of substituting. You see Tennessee substitutes, so now Kentucky's given that opportunity, but you're going to watch these linemen. You see at the bottom of the screen, they're going to really slow down. Watch here and here. Once they get to the bottom, they're basically walking. I mean, he's not hustling to get off. They're trying to give everybody a chance to catch their breath.
second down and 10, and Dylan Sampson, running back number 3, and he's electric as well. Takes it to the 40.
He is. He had 4 touchdowns in their first game against Virginia and 139 rushing yards against UTSA, and this coaching staff just couldn't ignore him anymore. They had to get this guy some more touches, and he's dynamic. On third down, he's also a weapon catching.
Stays in with Wright on the sideline, and here he is on the ground, and Sampson's got a first down.
Really good tough running and a bread and butter play is pulling their tackle. Gerald Mincy that time, the Florida transfer at right tackle, does a great job wheeling around, pinning a D lineman for Kentucky, opening up a crease.
Give it to Sampson again, and he is swarmed in the backfield by De'Aaron Jackson for no gain.
Yeah, De'Aaron Jackson, I think, has played really, really well. He just does a nice job. 54, just kind of get through the mess and find a way to tackle Sampson in the backfield.
On second down, there's pressure on Milton. Got it away to the sideline and too tall, intended for White.
And guess who? Deion Walker, the 350-pound D-tackle, the big cat, was right in Joe Milton's face. There's not going to be a lot of guys who scare a 6'5", 240-pound quarterback, but I think Deion Walker's one of them.
And a flag flies pre-snap.
That's Cooper Mays, their center, who missed the first 4 games with an upper body injury. And his last 3 games, he's been kind of trying to work his way back in it. You see there, the illegal snap's going to back Tennessee up even further. And now they might be out of field goal range with that penalty.
Backed up to the 36, and it's a screen. It's Squirrel White, and he gets hawked down by Keaton Wade. Some responses from Kentucky. Got their first points with the field goal from Rayner. And now they slow down Tennessee in plus territory. Charles Campbell comes out from 49. And Campbell's kick on its way. Hooking and good. Campbell's longest of the season restores the Tennessee lead to 10 in the second quarter. A team that you guys saw, Jesse and Katie, last week.
Yeah, went into Jordan-Hare, a place that was really tons of energy. They knew it was going to be tough, and Jackson Dart delivered big time late in that game with some big moments. Come away with a big win.
Barion Brown waiting for a chance, won't get it here. Well, check this out. The pride of the Commonwealth herself,
yeah.
Katie George.
Ask and you shall receive.
I just want to know if this is how Jesse Palmer feels every day.
No one ever asks for selfies with me, ever.
They're too scared.
They're too, yeah, I look like Jason. I look like the guy that was standing behind you right there.
Bugs on Jesse and Katie, Mike Monaco, our entire crew with you. Kentucky with it, down by 10, and Leary up the sideline, and he's got Barion Brown and a contested catch.
And that's big because Tennessee's without their biggest, best corner in this game for the rest of the season. Kamal Hatton out with an injury, so Kentucky goes out, takes a shot with their best deep threat, Barion Brown, against the backup corner, Danico Slaughter, and come away with another explosive play in the passing game.
32 yards, and now some up-tempo from the Wildcats, and Leary to Dane Key, and Leary looks like he's in a pretty good rhythm.
Well, going back to that last catch, that's nice. You're going to have to make contested plays and contested throws. Barion Brown, great release, stacks him, gives himself room to work with, and he looks back, he's able to locate that strong hands through the catch, and he's a guy, Mike, that's had some drop problems this year. That's a good sign. This Kentucky passing offense, this is as good as it's looked maybe all season.
Over the top of Danico Slaughter, as you said, stepping in for Kamal Hatton. Kentucky had four drops in the Missouri game. Liam Cohen said, this is going to be a contested catch type of game. On a pitch to Jatan McClain, and not much there. Well, tackle made by Herring.
Yeah, Mike, it seems obvious coming into this one that Tennessee said, okay, no Ray Davis. We're going to load the line of scrimmage, load the box. Number one is not going to beat us. So that's setting up one-on-one opportunities on the outside, and Kentucky's got to be able to hit those. And those chances have shown up early in this game. Devin Leary's finding the matchups. He's delivering accurate throws.
Talent is there with the Wildcat receivers.
It's there, but they have been banged up a little bit here in recent weeks. Berrian Brown and Tavian Robinson got injured against Florida. They feel like they're back close to 100% now for the first time in a while. And it's showing up.
Dekel Crowdis comes in as well. Top of your screen for Kentucky. Play clock winding down on Leary, and they got it away. Against the blitz, Leary incomplete, wanted Robinson.
You mentioned the blitz. When you're playing against this Tim Banks defense, you're becoming an active participant in a blitz-a-thon. He brings people from everywhere. The question is, where are they coming from? Is it going to be a linebacker? Is it a safety? Is it a nickelback, a corner? They're not all out blitzes or pressures, but they're just enough to try and confuse you. And that's a big reason why, as you mentioned earlier, Mike, they're fourth best in the nation in terms of sacks per game.
Something Tim Banks said to us last night, we identified as an area we had to improve on. Sets up another third down for Devin Leary at Kentucky. Still McClain and no Ray Davis. Four-man rush, and Leary zips one to the sideline for Key at a first down, and they move the sticks on third down.
Another great example of pass pro by the big blue wall. Marcus Cox now, the left tackle, working one-on-one here against one of the best in college football, and James Pierce, he just stones him. He gets run over, but it gives Devin Leary enough time to get that throw off for a huge completion on third down.
You really like Cox on that O-line.
I really do, and normally because of the run blocking, what he's able to do at the point of attack, he's not going to get style points, but at the end of the day, that was, he got the job done. He kept number 27 off of Devin Leary.
17 yards for the Wildcats. From the 15, on a direct snap, Davis keeps, and he finds about 3.5 yards.
Yeah, and it's been a quiet game so far for Ray Davis. You don't see this very often this year. Only 5 carries for 6 yards coming into this drive. So another example, put him in the Wildcat, get an extra blocker at the point of attack, and try and find ways to get this guy a crease.
They've been very creative in ways to try to get him the ball. You detailed it on the screens and then also on the direct snap. Trips to the right for Devin Leary midway through the second. Against four, Leary toward the end zone for Brown! And a touchdown! Contested catch, Berrian Brown!
It's the second time on the drive. Berrian Brown has had to make a contested catch with a defender draped all over him. Just running the wheel route and a perfect back shoulder throw by Devin Leary. You know what they say, there's no defense for a perfect throw. You cannot place it any better than the NC State transfer did right there.
How about 7 plays, 75 yards for Kentucky. And Devin Leary looks pretty good here in the first half. He's got Kentucky within 3 midway through this second. 10 of 13 through the air. 129 yards and the touchdown perfectly to the back shoulder for Berrian Brown. A great scene now at nightfall at Kroger Field, and Devin Leary's been sharp early on for Kentucky. Chance Poor puts it in the air, and no chance again for Williams. Tonight's Mark of a Fighter moment is brought to you by Modelo.
Kentucky's throwing some haymakers in the passing game, too. Here's Berrian Brown to Marion McDonald, who's going to be in the slot covering him. They're going to try to run some interference here and then run the wheel route in behind it, and they execute it perfectly. You see McDonald in the slot. He loses eye focus for just a split second, and that's all it took for Brown and his speed to get in behind him. Right now, Devin Leary is in rhythm. He's seeing the field. He's throwing the ball with conviction. This is easily the best this passing attack for Kentucky has looked.
And a couple of big catches, including the touchdown from Berrion Brown. Balls by three, and Milton keeps. Plenty of room up the left side for Joe Milton, just shy of the 45.
You know, guys, some quarterbacks like to get a couple quick completions early in the game to settle in. Joey Halsley says Joe Milton likes running the ball to get himself going. Now that he's feeling healthier, a couple early runs, even taking a couple hits, contact helps him find his rhythm and groove. Jesse, is that common?
Probably not. I know I needed to get hit a few times before I started to feel more comfortable, but, of course, I wasn't close to the athlete that Joe Milton was.
Second down and four, and it's Small with back-to-back carries. He's got a first down.
I think I would prefer to do it the Joe Milton way, probably run like a zone read for 20 yards to feel like I got into the rhythm before getting blindsided, sack, fumble, score. Yeah, I'll take the Joe Milton route.
6'5", 235. The first down. On the ground again with Small.
Man, I'm impressed with Tennessee up front, too, because Kentucky is a big, physical, dominant defensive line. They want to fight you in a phone booth. They're inviting you to run it between the tackles. They've only given up 95 rushing yards a game, second best in the SEC, but Tennessee is pushing them around.
And now Milton off the play fake. Takes another deep shot toward the end zone for a touchdown. Chaz Nimrod. Yards for his first career touchdown.
Nimrod one-on-one against Jordan Robinson out in corner, and Jordan Robinson just falls down. He gets beat right off the line of scrimmage. You can't catch up. You see him trip and fall. And that's just an easy pitch and catch. And it's been the explosive plays in the passing game that have been lacking from Tennessee's offense. Doesn't seem at all like it was a year ago when they had Hendon Hooker and Jalin Hyatt just lighting defenses up. But early in this game, getting it done running, and now throwing it deep as well.
Charles Campbell with the point after. 20-10 is the lead for the Vols. This is an explosive through the air for the Vols, and Chaz Nimrod, his first career touchdown. Both Tennessee touchdowns have been big plays. The first on the ground and now through the air.
See, last year when teams loaded the box to stop the run, they made you pay for it with 37 completions of 20 or more yards. This year that hasn't been the case. Part of that's Milton missing. Part of that's Brew McCoy being hurt. And part of that's receivers dropping passes. But early in this one, they are clicking on all cylinders.
Drive took a 122. And now a Turbyville touchback.
Turbyville's kick. You know, guys, I asked Joe Milton when he first realized he had a special arm. He said when he was 12 years old, he used to throw a football as high as he could over his home, and he would race to the other side trying to catch it before it would hit the ground, which is a pretty far distance to run. He said of the thousands of throws he made, he only caught the ball twice, but those two times told him all he needed to know, that his arm talent is different, and we just saw it on full display there.
Katie, it's ridiculous. He says he can throw it 90 yards, so when he's throwing a go route like he just did, that ball, what, traveled 55 yards? He's got a club down. That's like a six iron for him. I think that's been part of his problem throughout his career, is just trying to get the distance right.
I mean, that was a parabola through the air as Ray Davis fights for a couple of yards. Big drive here now for Kentucky.
Yeah, and again, they'd love to get Ray Davis going, but you got to give this Tennessee front four a lot of credit. They've been more physical inside the tackles, and they're forcing Devin Leary right now to have to beat them throwing it.
Tennessee will have it to start the third quarter up by 10.
You see them huddling. They kind of want to slow this thing way down. They would love to be able to drive the field here, bleed the clock, score some points, not give Joe Milton a lot of time left to work with, because, of course, Tennessee is going to be receiving first in the second half.
Here's Leary on second down. Throw sideline for Anthony Brown Stevens, who makes the catch for a first down for the freshman.
This is a fantastic job using the eyes for Devin Leary. They're just running kind of a go route on the outside in between a cover two look. And he's just watching the corner. There's a drag route coming over. The corner gets lost looking to the inside. That allows the window to open up, and a line drive bullet by Devin Leary.
For 20 yards, Now again, and that one, a bullet out of the arms of Tavion Robinson.
And again, I'm just really impressed with Devin Leary here and just how well he's seeing all the different looks Tennessee's showing him defensively. He's seeing the pressures. He's seeing the coverages. He knows where his answers are. Just looks so much more confident coming out of this bye week, Mike.
His coordinator, Liam Cohen, said to us, when he's slowed and everything is calm, he processes really well. Has done that here in the first half tonight. Sumo Kangbe squirts forward just a couple of yards, and now third down coming up.
And it's big Amari Thomas again making a stuff. And, you know, you look at this lineup for Tennessee inside at tackle. I think they've got five guys that'll play on Sunday. When you look at Eason, Thomas, Simmons, Garland, Norman Lott, all of these dudes, they make it very hard to run in between the tackles, which sets up third and long. And then that guy, number 27, James Pierce, he's screaming off the edge. Here he is lined up to the right side, one-on-one against the big right tackle, Jeremy Flax.
He's top 10 in the country in sacks. Sophomore off the edge. He drops back on third down. And Leary zips one to the sideline for Key and a first down.
And that's an NFL throw, man. I mean, you're throwing a comeback to the wide side of the field. Dane Key, great job coming back down the stem. But, I mean, this is the same Devin Leary we saw a couple years ago at NC State when he threw 35 TDs versus only five picks. That's the reason why a lot of people thought he might have been the best QB addition from the portal this offseason.
Davis on the ground, fights for a few yards. I mean, in that season, he was one of five finalists for the Johnny Unitas Award as the best quarterback in the country.
That's why I think a lot of people would say, you know, through seven games early this year, Kentucky maybe didn't get the return on investment they thought they were going to get. It's taken him some time, but, you know, this bye week came at a perfect moment for Kentucky. Obviously, starting 5-0, losing two straight, you get healthy. You get to self-scout, but really for their confidence and sort of resetting their focus, I think it was critical. I think there's a better example of that for an individual player than a QB.
Play fake and a rollout and a quick one to Josh Caddis, one of the tight ends. And he rumbles down toward the 20. There is a flag down back at the 27.
I think they might get defensive holding outside at the corner spot.
Defense number eight.
It's Brandon Turnage. He's working outside at cornerback right now, the Bama transfer, one-on-one against Robinson, who's really quick. And you see just grabbing the jersey, that's an easy call to make. And it has not taken Kentucky a long time to drive the field. This thing is like a heavyweight fight right now. Everybody just dropping blows, both offenses up and down the field.
That was 17 yards for Caddis. And Kentucky driving. 3:15 to go until halftime. Could be a double pass. Tavion Robinson instead takes off up the sideline toward the 15.
I love that decision by Robinson. How many times do you see receivers get a double pass opportunity and they just want a touchdown pass so bad they force it into double coverage? It ends up getting picked off. But you see right here, they're trying to squeeze and get the tight end in behind it. Not there. Very smart play. There's a guy that started 50 games in his career. That's why Liam Cohen further down the road will let him run that play again, because you're not going to put him on the chopping block. You make good decisions. You've got your coordinators back. Really, really smart job. Smart play.
Fifth-year senior started his career at Virginia Tech. Ninth play of the drive on second down. Davis breaks the tackle, and he's got a first down inside the 10, and it's first and goal.
Yeah, there's some good tough running there. He had Joshua Josephs. You see him just kind of run through that arm tackle. Josephs is a defensive end, and he's got the ability to go in between the tackles, but he's got the speed to take it outside too. And, you know, you really got to pack a lunch. I mean, it's important Tennessee brings hats to number one when he has the football, because this guy just does not go down easy, as Josephs just found out.
8 yards, his longest carry of the game.
And look at them just bleeding the clock again. They're huddling. They're letting this thing roll. This is working out perfect for Kentucky late here in the first half.
Davis into motion. They give it to him on the jet sweep. Davis to the edge. Touchdown.
one of the reasons this is such a great blocking offense is that it's not just the O-line. Tight ends have to get it done, too, on the perimeter. You're coming with the jet sweep this way. Guys got to be able to go out in space, get a hat on hat, and execute. Time and time again, Kentucky's been able to do that. It's not just physical play by the big blue wall. The tight ends have been outstanding this season as well.
10 plays, 75 yards in 4.5 minutes. And Alex Rayner's good on the point after. Well, they've been trying to get Ray Davis going. Tennessee is trying to slow him down, obviously, here in this first half. And on the jet sweep, it's Davis with touchdown number 14 in his season here in Lexington. Border rivalry between Tennessee and Kentucky getting late in this first half. How about the second quarter? We've had 27 points, 279 combined total yards.
It feels like whoever has the ball last could end up winning this game, right? It's been fun.
Fair catch signal from D. Williams. What's coming up, Matt Berry?
Gentlemen, Mercedes-Benz halftime report. The Bulldogs blow out Palmer's Gators. We'll have highlights of that, plus the Sooners stunned in Kansas. And Oregon overwhelms Utah in a big one of the Pac-12. Monaco, my question for you. Were you officially a Spro bro today, or did Palmer big time you?
No, Barry, he's a Spro step bro.
Yes.
Today. And Barry's like Sproto Baggins back in studio with his high chair behind that table, looking good.
He had to take a shot at Florida as well.
Everything was going so well.
First down, and there's nothing there for Dylan Sampson. Fifth drive for Tennessee. They've got points on the first.
Well, here's the problem. A minute 30 is an eternity for this Tennessee offense to drive the field and score. Plus, they have all their timeouts. It's plenty of time for Joe Milton to get this thing working.
Second down, and it's Sampson again up the middle. Takes it out to the 29, 4 yards, third down.
Well, you see this offense run it a lot in their two-minute drill, but Tennessee right now going a lot slower than I anticipate. I think there'd be a little bit more sense of urgency right now for Tennessee to try to steal some more points before getting it back first in the second half.
Third down at 6. Yeah, they soak some time here on the road.
It feels like they're just playing to have the lead into halftime.
Three-man rush. Milton searching and rolling and firing toward the sideline and trying to hook up over there and waiting on the signal for Ramel Keaton, and it looks like he's got it.
And that is an absolute laser on the throw. Was he in when he made the catch? I don't think so. They're going to want to take a look at that, aren't they?
See, if that right foot was down, they do not stop it. And now we do get a whistle mid-run from Sampson, and they do want to go back and have a look.
Okay, well, first off, that's the type of throw. Mark Stoops upset. He wants a faster review because he thought it was incomplete as well. But that's the type of throw from Joe Milton.
Replay review was initiated. The ruling on the field is a completed catch. Viewers, plays under further review.
Yeah, Mark Stoops is saying you got to take a look at that again. But, I mean, that's the throw that makes you believe Joe Milton's a top 10 pick. That's ridiculous. Of course, every starting quarterback in the NFL can make that throw, but you can count a handful of guys that make it look like that. On the run, absolute laser. Goes about 35, 40 yards. But to me, is that right foot still down in bounds when Keaton makes the catch? Doesn't look like it to me. When he has full possession of that throw,
right there.
Now, the question is, was that right toe still down in the field of play?
And is there enough evidence, of course, to overturn the call on the field of catch?
You need indisputable video evidence. There's really good coverage by Hairston on the back end. That's the only place he could have put that football to make the catch. At this point, I got to be honest, I don't know if there's anything or any
that conclusively tells you
that you could overturn that from all the angles we just saw. The call on the field was that it was a catch.
Our rules expert, Matt Austin, chiming in our ears, saying that he, too, doesn't know if there's enough to overturn. Now, the other question is there control of the catch? Because the ball moving a bit along the sideline at the end, even after that right foot comes up.
Well, take a look there. I mean, the ball's obviously moving. Does he have complete and continuous control of it through the catch? It's certainly moving. Kind of has his left pinky on it.
Boy, that's going to be tough.
Yeah, that's tough. I mean, it doesn't look like a catch, but is there enough evidence there to overturn it? And that's a big play, too. Here's Tennessee. They're going slow. They're on their own end. It looks like they're playing just to get into halftime with the lead. One big throw. All of a sudden, if this stands, sets them up at midfield. With all their timeouts, they're in position to score.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. It's a completed kick. First down for Tennessee. Used to set the game clock for 32 seconds. 32.
Saw the replay official John Bible working in tandem with Steve Marlowe.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of what we were talking about there. Kentucky fans can't believe it, but you know, again, the call in the field, and you need the evidence on video replay to overturn it. I just don't think they had it.
Kentucky doesn't like it, and again, they came together for a while before they even signaled that it was a catch in the initial call from Ramel Keaton. Picks up 17 on third down and 6, and as you said, out to midfield now with Tennessee operating with 32 seconds and all three timeouts.
Probably feel like at least to get into field goal range, you probably got to get this thing somewhere close to the 30-yard line. So you got about 22 yards to go. Plenty of time with all those timeouts in their back pocket.
Even Scooby-Doo upset here in Lexington. First down. And Milton throws it toward the sticks, and Keaton gets out of bounds after he got about 7.
Really good awareness there that time by Ramel Keaton, understanding the situation. 2-minute drill here, finding the sideline if you can get out to stop the clock.
Ramel Keaton, the second leading receiver, fifth-year senior from Georgia.
We got a substitution problem that time. Keyshawn Silver was jogging off the field. The coach had to run out to him and say, no, you're not going out. Get back out there.
Nose guard does, and now Milton on second down across the middle. Spinning is Sampson, and stayed on his feet before he's gang tackled by Kentucky.
Tennessee should take a timeout here. Go talk this over. You hear the boos from the Kentucky crowd, upset about the call just a few plays ago.
15 seconds to go here in the half. Hey, coming up tomorrow on Sunday NFL Countdown, go all access with Travis Kelce and Jalen Hurts, plus Adam Schefter with the latest trade deadline news, 10 a.m. Eastern, right here on ESPN. And then this week on Monday Night Football, the Detroit Lions at 5-2, they host the Las Vegas Raiders, 8 o'clock Eastern on ABC and on ESPN. Jesse Palmer, Mike Monaco back with you. Katie George down on the sideline as well. This has been quite the first half.
Yeah, and it's going back and forth. And we knew Tennessee coming into this game was going to be a team that wanted to run the football. Jalen Wright's been sensational in the first half. They've run it for over 250 yards. I think the bigger surprise is it hasn't been Ray Davis so much for Kentucky as it's been Devin Leary. He's been so good throwing it right now. They're finding explosive plays. He's taking care of the football. And this thing is back and forth. And again, it just has the feel right now in the first half like whoever has the ball last is going to win this game.
They have played a lot of close ones in the history of this rivalry, and the first half here tonight at Kroger Field's been no different. All right, so they put 17 seconds on the clock. Tennessee's got it at the 41, 2 timeouts left. Milton steps up, searching and throwing, and he's got his man. Squirrel White is wrapped up by Phillips on a good game with 7 seconds. And now they stop it.
Fantastic job on the scramble drill that time. Milton rolling to his right. You got receivers that have to fight and work their way back open and find green grass. And just an outstanding throw again on the move by Joe Milton. You see that? I mean, it looks like Superman making these throws. Some pressure coming on the outside. Sampson gets a piece of him. It allows him to buy time. You start with the curl route. You break it back to the inside. So much quickness by Squirrel White on the outside here. This is going to be a curl on the boundary, try to get out of bounds, but you just find open grass. You work away from where you came from, and Oftentimes for QBs, throwing back across your body on the move to your right if you're right-handed is the cardinal sin. But, man, when you got this guy's arm talent, it is scary. And that's another top 10 pick type play by Joe Milton.
I mean, threw one rolling that way to Keaton, and now rolling the same way, but as you said, across the body.
Yeah, I feel like 20 seconds ago they were on their own 25-yard line, and all of a sudden here they are with an opportunity to steal some more points before getting the football back first here in the second half.
Clock rolled when it shouldn't have, so with 7 seconds left in this half, they trot out Charles Campbell. From 34 yards for Charles Campbell. Jackson Ross, the holder. And Campbell is up and good. So it felt like they were backed up on their 25, and then on third down, Milton with a call that stood to Keaton, and that set it all in motion.
Man, we talked about needing to be better throwing it vertically down the field. Joe Milton has shown that. He's shown you a little bit of everything in this game, too. We've seen some running ability of him. But right here on this two-minute situation, the scramble throw to Squirrel right there at the end. We've seen the zone read. It's a great job. You see his athleticism for a guy that's 6'5", 240 pounds. And then he's found his matchups one-on-one. Here's the six-iron throw down the boundary to a wide-open target, Chaz Nimrod. And a little magic dust putting on a show. Both these quarterbacks have been dialed in. And that was very impressive in a two-minute drill where at the beginning, again, it looked like it was very lackadaisical. But he's been doing it running it. He's been doing it throwing it.
Both quarterbacks who have had uneven or up and down in some cases seasons to this point.
Yeah, it's fun to see a quarterback duel here. But the midway, you know, point of the season, getting into the last third, and both these guys, man, they came ready to play, dialed in to the game plan. And you got to love what you're seeing if you're the head coach on both teams from your quarterback.
And 5 seconds remaining. Turbyville will have this one come out from Berrion Brown. Up the middle of the field, and no time remaining here at the end of the half. And Brown is slow to get up. So that does it for the first half. Tennessee 23, Kentucky 17. Took some time for the Cats offense to get in gear. And meanwhile, for the Vols, they came out with the big plays. And they have the 6-point lead on Devin Leary and Kentucky after 30 minutes. Down to Katie.
Coach Heupel, you scored points on all five of your first half drives. How would you assess your offense's play so far?
Like a lot of what we've done, we got to finish when we get in the red zone. Defensively, love the way we started. We got to get back. They've hurt us with some play action pass. We got to have our eyes in the right place and then go play the man coverage.
Thank you.
Thank you.
23-17 is Josh Heupel's lead on Kentucky. Let's get you to the studio for our halftime report with Joey Galloway and Dan Mullen. Here's Matt Berry. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. Tennessee's got the lead on the road against Devin Leary and Kentucky as we start the second half. Welcome you back to Kroger Field. Jesse Palmer, Mike Monaco with you, and you said it in the first half. Haymakers on both sides, exchanging blows.
Yeah, which defense can get a stop? It's kind of what it feels like right now. Tennessee's hitting on all cylinders, right? They're running it at about 9 yards a clip. Joe Milton's dialed in. It's been all Devin Leary, though, for Kentucky. They've been outstanding throwing it. They need more Ray Davis. They need more balance here in the second half. But which of these defenses can get a turnover? Which one can force a punt? That may go a long way in determining who wins this game.
Such a key spot in the season for both these teams. You see at 5-2, both coming off losses and a fork in the road tonight. Chance Poor's kickoff is a fair catch.
You guys, Coach Stoops told me at half, look, it comes down to one explosive run and one explosive pass. He said the defense is battling. They put a lot of stress on you, but he was happy with the way his offense responded. He said you can't go 3 and out against these guys. It's not a good recipe. We have to match them by moving the football, and he thinks they did that in the first half. He said, look, holding them to field goals is preferred, but that's not going to sustain us. We have to get stops here in the second half if we want to win this game at home.
Yeah, Katie, you got to wonder the confidence of this defense right now after giving up 51 against Georgia a few games ago. Missouri scored on 7 of their last 9 drives the last time out. And you mentioned it right when we were going to halftime, Katie. Tennessee scored on all 5 drives in this one, too. So Tennessee needs a stop for their confidence and for their momentum.
Jalen Wright for 6. How do you think Kentucky defensively has handled the tempo?
Not great. And, you know, that's a problem right now. Playing with better eye discipline and focus, getting the call in, getting the substitutions in, that's always a problem. It's not so much the physical. It's the mental. It's getting everybody lined up properly, getting everybody's eyes in the right place.
That's exactly what Brad White, the defensive coordinator, said to us. 3rd down, it's short, and it's Milton, and De'Aaron Jackson got to him for no gain. 4th down.
That's a phenomenal job. They go with the QB run there on 3rd and short, and it was De'Aaron Jackson able to kind of weave around the right side of the offensive line, get a tackle in the backfield. Zion Childress, the safety, also getting involved. And that might be the play that Kentucky needed to help their momentum as we see Tennessee offensive lineman Dan on the ground. It looks like John Campbell, the Miami transfer at left tackle, who's been so critical for them this year up front.
Left guard Andre Carrick got hurt in the first half for the Vols, and now the left tackle John Campbell. We'll check on him when we come back. First minute of this second half. You're watching the SEC on ESPN.
And Mike, the ESPN analytics model says to go for it right here on 4th down for Tennessee. But one thing that the model doesn't take into account is the fact that they just lost their starting left tackle, John Campbell, to an injury. I think that's impacting Josh Heupel's decision to punt it.
So he trots out Jackson Ross, redshirt freshman from Australia, who can boot it with both feet. Coming off a really good one against Alabama. And he gets this away in the direction of Tavion Robinson, who makes a fair catch at the 30.
This is the best we've seen Devin Leary play this year, throwing the ball. He's made really good decisions. 13 for 17 so far. He's been patient, clean pocket, letting plays develop, accurate throws. Here's the NFL deep comeback to the wide side of the field, putting it right on Dane Key's face mask. His deep balls look really good this time, hitting Barry and Brown down the sideline on a go, and then the back shoulder throw. Location, location, location to Brown on the wheel route. Now, the key is, we talked about this in the open, they have not yet seen 4 quarters of good play from Devin Leary this year. That was an outstanding first half. But to win this game, you just get the sense, Mike, they're going to need him to play big here for 2 more quarters.
Had been 54% for the season. You saw better than 70%. It's Davis on the ground for a good gain on first down.
Yeah, and they got to get him going as well. This guy leads the SEC in rushing yards, and he's the type of guy that can get stronger as the game goes on. We talked about the big blue wall from Kentucky up front. They like to try to wear defensive lines down. What Ray Davis has done this season, nothing short of phenomenal. And both these guys have just been ballers for their respective offenses. Jalen Wright, he's only done 99 yards on 7 carries. They've gotten him off. It's now time for Ray Davis to get going.
Davis, a guy, of course, who went for 280 on the ground in that win over Florida at the end of September. Second down at 4, and Leary, quick throw. Dane Key lowers the shoulder out to midfield and barks at Gabe Judy Lally.
And just a lot of cushion by Tennessee on the back end. Gabe Judy Lally, the transfer from BYU out here in corners, giving a lot of space on this hitch route. You saw Roman Harrison there, number 30, a defensive end. He just kind of got his eye stuck inside on the play fake before Devin Leary made a good decision on an RPO just to spit that outside.
Bryson Eason, redshirt junior defensive tackle, stepped into a big role this year. He is down grabbing at his leg.
He's been good, too. I talked earlier about how good I think these D tackles are. Number 20 is a big part of the rotation for Tennessee, and he's a guy that can just walk linemen back into the lap of the QB and a guy that Tennessee needs here in the second half.
We step aside in Lexington with Tennessee up by 6 in the 3rd. Back in a blink to Lexington, Kentucky. 1st down and 10 from midfield for Devin Leary. Against pressure across the middle, Tavion Robinson is swarmed just shy of the 1st down stick by Wesley Walker.
Another good example of Kentucky picking up the blitz. Eli Cox, the center this time, is going to see it coming from the right-hand side. He gets that scooped up in a clean pocket against pressure, allows Devin Leary to make an accurate throw.
2nd down and 1. And Ray Davis takes on Jalen McCullough, and he's got a first down.
You know, it's crazy. I tell you, Tennessee came into this one wanting to stop the run, make Devin Leary beat them. They're playing to their game plan perfect, except they can't affect Devin Leary. And remember, they were averaging 4 sacks a game. They have not been able to get home. They have zero in this game, whether they're rushing 3, 4, or blitzing. The pass rush that's been so good for Tennessee all year, that's got to show up here at some point in the second half, I think, if Tennessee's going to win.
The big blue wall, that offensive line as it's known for the Wildcats, who you said coming in, if you're just joining us, better blocking the run than pass protection. Eli Cox, the anchor in the middle. First down, here's Leary. Feels the pressure, and right on cue, he is sacked by Omar Norman Lott, and the first for the Vols getting home.
Well, Barron's going to be the one at defensive end that forces Leary to step up, and then it's Norman Lott that finishes it. He's twitchy from Arizona State inside for a big man. You see Barron come out here, gets the contain. Leary's got to step up, and there's the pass rush we've seen time and time again from Tennessee this year. It's important Kentucky does not get behind the sticks. This is an offense that has struggled for most of the season throwing it, but you do not want to let this Tennessee Volunteer front pin their ears back in obvious situations because they've got dudes.
First one for either team in this game and a loss of 11. And on second and long for Leary. Pressure again. He climbs, checks it down, and Davis dropped a juggling bid, and now it's third down and a mile.
Well, two straight plays, and if you're Liam Cohen in this situation right here, you've got to have a plan for James Pierce. They've done a good job so far, but Pierce is going to be coming off the right side or the left side. He's one of the best pass rushers in the entire country. They're going to have him lined up against Jeremy Flax, the right tackle. You need a tight end or a running back chipping to help a guy in Pierce who's got sacks now in three straight games.
So they've got Jordan Dingell, a tight end, beside Flax to help out on Pierce. Kentucky's 3 of its last 4 on third downs. Four-man rush, and Leary rifles one, and he's got Dingell, who gets crunched down in plus territory, brings up fourth down.
Fantastic job again picking that up. It looked like an overload pressure coming from the left side, but you'll see Flax do a great job, great feet. Giving the clean pocket again for Dingell just to hook up. And now you've got fourth and short, and it looks like Mark Stoops wants to go.
Long for Alex Rayner this year is 50. This would be 51. And again, our analytics model says this is the right call. Devin Leary, 16 of 21 so far in this one. On fourth down, here's the blitz. Leary stands in toward the sideline and broken up by Tamarian McDonald to force a turnover on downs.
What a play by McDonald. And remember, he was beat on a wheel route for the touchdown to Barry and Brown. This time they had Carnbay in the slot running the same route. And McDonald did a much better job this time in coverage. That's a mano-a-mano wheel route. He does a great job fighting through the traffic, going up over top, then locating the ball, swatting it away clean. It's been the biggest area of improvement, I think, for this defense, too, Mike, this year. Last year, they were the fourth worst pass defense in all of college football. They've had a more consistent pass rush this season, but they've had better play outside one-on-one on islands. And in a game where they lose Kamal Haddon, their last time out, big play by McDonald.
Milton runs it on first down, finds a lane, and he's got a first down. After the second turnover on downs from Kentucky, we've got a marker back at the 34.
Holding, offense number 53, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Jeremiah Crawford, who has stepped in with Campbell and Carrick going down on the left side of the Vols.
That's right. He spent a lot of time last year at left tackle. That time just getting a little bit too handsy on what looked like was going to be an explosive run there for Joe Milton.
Crawford, a guy with starting experience, like you said, has also battled injury this year and planned for the first time in a few weeks after getting healthy. He's at left tackle opposite Gerald Mincy. On the ground with Wright, and he tumbles forward, and now it's second down and 19 for the Vols.
You guys, I've been watching John Campbell over here on Tennessee's sideline. He's dealing with a right ankle injury. He spent some time in the medical tent, went through his footwork. He's been limping a whole lot. Looks like he's in pain, and he's still over here on the sideline. He has his helmet, which is generally a good sign.
Ball shape-shifting up front with that five-man group. Milton under some pressure from Walker, directing, firing, and he's got a man. Dante Thornton in the plus territory. And there's the Dante Thornton Vol Nation has been waiting on.
We saw great examples on the two-minute drive at the end of the first half on the scramble drill and guys working to get open. This time, right-handed quarterback going to the left, and he's got a receiver working back across his body. Natural arm talent. It's like a shortstop turning two.
47 yards, and now Wright picks up nine.
When this tempo gets going, when they get a big chunk play, they like to go really fast, and the defense all of a sudden is on their heels. They're trying to get a call. Are we subbing? Are we not? Backs against the wall.
Right again with a first down and a burst. Swung down just outside the 10 by Drew Phillips.
Yeah, right now, Jeremiah Crawford, you were just talking about at left tackle, he's doing a nice job here in the run game. He's one-on-one outside with J.J. Weaver, and he's winning. And that's giving creases for Jalen Wright to run through on that left side.
Wright's got 10 for a buck 17. Option. Milton. Pitch. Right. Edge. And banged out of bounds after a couple by Zion Childress, the safety.
Josh Heupel told us he wants better production in the red zone, right? And again, the best offenses are the ones that run it down in this area of the field. It can be conventional turning around and handing it off. It can be QB runs, option game. You're seeing a little bit of everything right now for Tennessee down here.
You think the best red zone offenses can run it well?
Yeah, because it's hard to throw in this area, right? The windows are really small. They open and close so quickly. And for a passing offense like Tennessee that has struggled this season, it's critical here they keep getting it done on the ground.
Milton tried to get free and he cannot out of the grasp of Keaton Wade.
That was just a design QB run all the way with trying a little misdirection, but Keaton Wade wasn't fooled and he made the tackle for loss in the backfield. Now can the pass rush for Kentucky show up? See, they're trying to pull a backside guard in Ollie Lane to scoop him up. Couldn't get there in time. Here's where now in a situation Kentucky's pass rush has to go.
Third down. Milton ducks away from pressure and he's dropped.
J.J. Weaver makes the play, but Deion Walker gets the sack. It's a little game up front by Kentucky. Great job. Weaver coming inside and then a 350-pound D tackle just collapsing the pocket. Very little for Joe Milton to do here. Great instincts and great quickness by Walker. I just don't know how a guy that big moves like that. I'm telling you, man, every time you watch him on film, each and every week, he's showing up making plays.
Leads them in pressures, and he got home. And now Charles Campbell from 35 yards trying to make this a two-score game. And Campbell off the upright and good.
Wow.
Woo.
Trick or treat. Man, lucky bounce for Tennessee.
The rare field goal replay because, yeah, Charles Campbell off the right, upright, and in.
Got the members bounce.
Oh. Take that anytime on the road in Lexington, Kentucky.
That's what I...
These border rivals separated by 170 miles, and how about the last three in Lexington, all close ones. In 17, it was Kentucky by three, Tennessee by four a couple of years later, and then 2 years ago in a game that feels a lot like tonight's, Hendon Hooker started away.
Yeah, these things always end kind of crazy when they play here in Lexington. This one also feels like it's going to be going down to the wire.
Josh Turbyville with a touchback. And now a quick word from Verbo.
We're here live in the family room of this Verbo vacation home. It's a house divided for this rematch between bitter rivals. Man, it's a good thing Verbo gives you the whole house, so there's plenty of space to go around. Back to you.
So in meeting number 119, Kentucky back on offense after the turnover on downs. And remember, to close the first half, they scored on three straight possessions. Midway through this third in Lexington, Jesse Palmer, Katie George, Mike Monaco. This game produced by Scott Matthews and directed by Jeff Evers. Play fake and Leary to the field and a catch by Berrion Brown for a first down.
Another real nice throw in rhythm that time by Devin Leary. A wide field out route. It's a speed out by Brown and throwing off his back foot in time. No hitch by Devin Leary. That's just beautiful. He's got his feet underneath him. Good balance. Take the completion. Move the chains.
Berrion Brown's got 4 for 50. Davis tried to bounce it outside. He gets 3.
Just nothing on the inside, right? We're used to seeing him find creases and get into the second level. Hasn't been able to do that. Tennessee very stout.
An apparent offside call coming against Tennessee.
Offside. Defense number 27. Lined up at the neutral zone at the snap. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
That's the second time that's happened for Tennessee in this game. Joshua Joseph's got called for that. And those are the penalties. We talked about both these teams having problems with that, but Josh Heupel not going to be happy.
His team last in the SEC with 8 penalties per game. And we showed you in the first half that, much like Kentucky, these teams the worst 2 in the SEC in penalty yards against per game. 6 to go, third quarter. And now another flag gets dropped in right by the line of scrimmage. Second week in a row they've called that on Elijah Herring.
Yeah, he's trying to clap and simulate a snap count from the offense. That's what the referees say they're doing. And I think Elijah Herring's saying, look, I'm just trying to communicate to my front, tell guys to shift. That's been a problem here in recent games.
I mean, they were talking about Elijah Herring needing to clap more gently after the call last time out against Alabama.
How do you do a golf clap?
Yeah, I guess so. Davis left side, and he squirts past the 50. Yeah, the clap belongs to the offense, Matt Austin says. So the defense, regardless of volume,
wave your hands, yell louder.
Mix it up.
Yeah. Jazz hands. Whatever it takes. Man, it's like life's already hard enough on the defense, isn't it? With spread up tempo offense and everything that's going on, RPOs now. And now you can't clap.
Heat of the moment, you're in a rivalry matchup. And Herring gets tagged for that. Second down and 5. From the 48, play action again, and Leary in rhythm. Another completion, and Dane Key breaks away. At the 15, he's out of bounds.
Well, it was a nice route concept there. They had Dingle, the tight end, just kind of running a spot route. And it's able to affect the defense and open up a window. He's going to start here. You're going to see 27 Pierce just run outside that way. That opens the route or the window for the dig by Dane Key, doing a nice job making the catch, pivoting, and getting downfield. And again, Mike, the conviction Devin Leary's throwing the ball with now. It's been a couple years since we've seen this from him.
34 yards that time. And remember, Josh Heupel said to Katie before halftime he was concerned about the play action from Kentucky. Inside the red zone with 4 to go in the third. Leary rolls out. And now takes off. And Devin Leary slides down in the vicinity of the 5 using his legs.
It's amazing. You know, in the Missouri game, we saw more runs out of him and down in the red zone. He scored on a QB draw. Actually, also scored in a zone read, but it was called back because of a penalty. And that's just a really good decision. You're out on the perimeter. You're looking for a throw in the flat. It's not there. Cut back to the middle of the field. Get what you can get and set up 2nd and 2.
Couple of tight ends in this 12 personnel for the Wildcats from the 6. Davis off the right side, and again, nothing there for Ray Davis, the top rusher in the SEC.
We saw Bryson Easton, who went down with an apparent injury a few plays ago. He made a big-time play that time, just stymieing offensive linemen at the point of attack. And you can see why this defense is averaging 8 tackles for loss. There he is working against the right guard, just nothing going. And they've got 5 guys like that that can come in, fresh legs. They've been living in the opponent's backfield all season long.
You said you think those 5 have NFL futures.
I do. They've recruited so well at that position and gotten some help from the portal as well.
Third down and three. Leary, easy access. He's got his man for a touchdown. And it's Dane Key. And six for the Cats.
There's a great example of Devin Leary and Dane Key being on the same page. That's a simple stick route. They ran that exact same play against Florida in the first quarter and missed what should have been a touchdown. You see the top on the right side? Zone coverage, pivots to the outside. It's zone, so you're not going to break out running. You're just curling up. And Devin Leary knows, I'm going to put that on your outside shoulder. You're going to catch it and turn up to score. I don't know what they were doing in the bye week, but Mike, this passing attack looks completely different.
Liam Cohen said to us, we got to be better on third downs offensively. They were there, and Dane Key is having himself a day. He connects with Leary, 2-point margin in the third. All season long, student sections across the country are competing to be the Taco Bell Live Boss student section of the year. Download the Taco Bell app to learn more. This is one of the first schools to play college football at night. They had the first home night game here all the way back in 1929 against Maryville, and it is quite the scene here in Lexington. Tennessee will get it up by two late third. Hey, Tuesday on ESPN, it's the College Football Playoff Top 25 show presented by Allstate. What do you got, Jesse?
A lot of football to play. Because of resume, I've got Ohio State 1 winning at Notre Dame, beating Penn State without Burke, without Ibuka, I thought was huge. Georgia, not as dominant as a year ago, but what they did today to the Gators without Brock Bowers was impressive. Eye standpoint, eye test, Michigan looks the best. Haven't really played anybody. That'll change November 11th when they play Penn State. And Oregon beating Utah today the way they did made Washington's win against the Ducks look so much better. I've got Florida State at 5 and Texas, the big win against Alabama. And winning today with a backup quarterback in Malik Murphy, I thought was impressive.
You had Oklahoma in that 6th spot.
And then just it's weeks like this. It just seems like ho-hum. That's when chaos always seems to start to unravel.
Go to ESPN.com/Allstate Playoff Predictor to check out your team's chances to make the college football playoff. It's Keaton on first down.
Yeah, you see how Joe Milton just spits that out so quickly. Kentucky now trying to stop this running game. They got more bodies close to the line of scrimmage, which opens up one-on-ones outside. If you don't make a tackle, it's a home run.
Jabari Small pushes the pile, brings up third down about one.
It's going to be so critical for Kentucky here now. The rest of this game, they've got to slow the running game down with just 6 guys in the box. They've been so good, so physical all year, stopping it with those big bodies up front. That's got to continue here. We've seen Tennessee go to QB run here in these situations.
And Milton is under center. Hands it off to Small, and he's dragged down. Short of the line to gain, it brings up fourth down.
Well, up front, it was Deion Walker and Josiah Haynes. They just weren't allowing anything to happen. Josh Heupel earlier here in the second half decided not to go for it. He's going for it here.
They're 0 for 5 the last couple of weeks, and now all sorts of pre-snap movement. And who went first?
They were saying it was 97. I thought it was Octavius Oxendine, number 8, who flinched a little bit right up the middle. But a great job that time. We've seen some false start issues for Tennessee. Nice job by them that time, holding their water, getting the automatic first.
And then the Spider-Man gif on both sides of the line of scrimmage. Milton lowers his shoulder for about a yard or two. Deion Walker, the tackle.
Yeah, and Oxendine that time getting into the backfield, too. This defensive line now starting to play a little bit better. You can see them playing with a lot more confidence here, coming alive.
On second down, Small stacked up again as this defense under Brad White in the second half has searched for answers.
Yeah, we talked about what their confidence would be. 5 of the last 6 years, it's been a top 25 defense here. And all of a sudden now, down 2, trying to get each other fired up, and you can hear the crowd now getting into it as well.
Third down at 5. Pressure, and Milton goes down. Ox and dine the first to him.
They run a little game this way and bring the blitz this way, but everything kind of collapses over there on the left-hand side. Remember, that's Jeremiah Crawford now at left tackle, taking over for the injured John Campbell, and he just could not get it done against Oxendine.
Tavion Robinson back deep, and he will get it in the fourth quarter. Kentucky's defense has come to life out of halftime. They trail by two on Tennessee to the fourth after this.
Coach Stoops, how do you build off the momentum of that sack to win this game?
Well, it was a big stop right there. Could have hurt us when we jumped on fourth and one. I love the way our defense regrouped and got another stop. We're going to have to play good in all sides. They're going to put pressure on us, you know that. They could score at any moment. We got to play good in all phases.
Thank you. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Mark Stoops, calm as ever, and now through the smoke show.
Yeah, this is very Halloween-y.
On the last Saturday of October, we start the fourth with Jackson Ross going lefty this time. Tavion Robinson, a fair catch at the 20, and we check in with Matt Berry in the studio.
All right, gentlemen, All-State, good hands, plays of the day. We're starting with Stanford. 2 weeks in a row, Washington's messed around with a team they're better than. Alec Eilmanner with the big game against Colorado is doing it again. Washington just leads 21-19. And another game we're keeping an eye on, our All-State good hands plays. Wisconsin has tied it with Ohio State 10 apiece in the third quarter.
Yeah, McCord having some problems in that game. He's thrown a couple of early interceptions after the big win against Penn State, now struggling with Camp Randall.
Quarterbacks here have been very good, and Ray Davis has been quiet. Top running back in the SEC by the numbers.
So it's going to have to be Devin Leary here in the fourth quarter, continuing to deliver. And again, we've said this time and time over and over. Hasn't put four quarters together, but you need him now, right? This defense is hell-bent on stopping Ray Davis. But with the way Devin Leary's been playing up to this point in the game, I think if you're Lee and Cohen, the offensive coordinator, you should feel confident no matter what you're dialing up. 13 can come through for you.
You wrote it down on your notepad after three quarters against Missouri, the best he had played.
Yep.
Can he finish here tonight now in the fourth? Second down off a play fake. And Leary checks it down to Ray Davis. And Davis reaches out for a first down, carrying in on the stop.
Just seeing really good decisions by Devin Leary in all facets of this game. When to tuck it and run, like here, when to not take a shot. Nothing open downfield, just find your check down Ray Davis early, and by getting it to him early, he's able to get north up the field. How are they able to see right now?
Yes.
This is like Bears-Eagles in the late 80s.
Matt Berry was talking about the first snow game of the year. We've got a smokeout.
What is going on?
Jatan McClain checks in here at running back. And the ball at the 30 for the Cats. Play action again, and Leary takes a shot, and a great catch by Dane Key reaching out.
Dane Key through the fog. He's 6'3". He's got long arms with a tremendous catch radius. You just got to put it somewhere near him, and he can pluck it. That's an outstanding catch between two defenders. And again, Kentucky on the move.
7 for 113 for Dane Key, the sophomore from right here in Lexington, who last time out had just one catch against Mizzou. From midfield, they are letting Leary cook, and he throws into double coverage for Brown.
You know, guys, Liam Cohen was singing Dane Key's praises this week. Cohen said Key has been more intentional with his route running and ball skills as of late. He said Key wants to do well so badly that sometimes in games he bugs out. He gets too juiced up. But the last few weeks, they've been really pleased with Key's approach, consistency, and desire to be a go-to guy for Leary.
Yeah, Katie, it really comes down to practice reps, too. Staying late on the field afterwards and working the route tree together. That's how you build the confidence in the chemistry. We've really seen that show up here in this game.
It's had a big day for Kentucky in tandem with Devin Leary.
Four-man rush. Leary across the middle in rhythm again and a first down. And it's Demi Sumo-Kangbe.
And that's him on an island in the slot working an option route. He can go outside or inside. He's just going to work off of the leverage of the defender. And this time here, it gives him a little shake left. Breaks across his face. He was matched up one-on-one with linebacker Aaron Beasley. And that's a matchup Kentucky should feel good about in the passing game.
The things the Cats wanted to do better and different out of the bye week, they've done.
This is fun to watch, too, Mike, because you're seeing really all the volume of offense that Liam Cohen has here for Kentucky. So many different things they do. They got a Wildcat right now with Ray Davis.
Takes the direct snap and keeps it. And that's not going to get him going.
I mean, we see pro style, right? You see Devin Leary under center, and you see I formation and fullbacks and tight ends. Then they go empty, and they've got RPO plays, and now they've got Wildcat. It's just so much volume to prepare for if you're Tennessee's defense coming into this game. And there have been a few new wrinkles that Liam Cohen's been sprinkling their way, too.
A guy with the experience of running Sean McVay's system. Now here in college, again, back in Lexington. Twelve personnel, a tight end on each side for Devin Leary. Play action again against the pressure, and it's batted down by Pierce.
Man, and it looked like they may have had something on that. They were trying to sneak Josh Caddis on a tight end screen. He would have had to make one guy miss, and if he did, that was going to be a house call. You always want to run screens against the blitz. That's exactly what they had. But a great job up front by Tennessee, knocking that one down. Great athleticism there by Pierce. Now setting up third. Can Kentucky keep Devin Leary upright the way they've been doing for most of this football game? They've had a plan for Pierce all game long. We've got a tight end lined up over here. Try to help out potentially.
They're right at the edge, by the way, of Alex Rayner's range. On third and 11, Leary to the sideline for Brown, and incomplete. Fourth down with Judy Lally in coverage.
Nice job on the perimeter, one-on-one. We've seen Brown make a couple plays downfield in the vertical passing game for Kentucky. Kentucky going to line up for a very long field goal here to try to take the lead.
The long this year for Alex Rayner is 50. Said earlier this year, he feels comfortable from 55 and in. This from 53. For Alex Rayner and for the lead, and he pulled it. Comes up empty. Now there is a flag down back at the 31.
I wonder if they're going to get leaping.
The result of the play is a field goal that is no good. After the play, personal foul, defense number 6. 15-yard penalty will be assessed from the 15-yard spot. It'll be first down, Tennessee.
Wow, so that changes the field position. The miss stays in effect, and Aaron Beasley whistled for it for the Vols. Two-point game, first few minutes of the fourth, and Tennessee is in front in Lexington.
Aaron Beasley here, Dylan Ray exchanging pleasantries after that missed field goal. They're locked up. You got something on your cheek. I got it for you. Don't worry. Problem is you did it right in front of the referee.
So it backs up Tennessee to the 20, and Beasley sulks. Falls by two, 21st-ranked team in the country after a third quarter offensively where Kentucky really stepped things up defensively. And Dylan Sampson on the ground for just a yard. This is the worst starting field position for Tennessee tonight.
Yeah, Davin Rayner, nice job coming in now. Backup linebacker on the field, making a huge play.
On second down, here is Milton against pressure. Firing to the sideline, he's got Dante Thornton for a first down past the 30.
Tell you, Dante Thornton's done a pretty good job in this game. We've seen him more on the outside than we have previously in the season, but he's been winning some one-on-one matchups.
Former top 100 recruit transferred in from Oregon. Hadn't had a catch in more than a month.
And on first down, De'Eriq Jackson blows up Dylan Sampson.
It's so impressive when you watch Jackson and how he's able to kind of Olay lineman. That time, big right tackle Gerald Mincy pulling around the corner, and he kind of wrong shoulders him and dips underneath it. Look at 54, just kind of like wrong shoulders it, then gets in the backfield and makes a play.
Super solid linebacker for the Cats. On second down, they shovel it, and Sampson bounces away. Sampson spinning to the edge, and it looked like it was going to be nothing for the Vols.
And he broke a tackle from Walker. We've been seeing Walker just terrorizing this offense. Walker didn't wrap up. Somehow Sampson was able to stay on his feet.
Bounced away from 350 pounds. And now Milton gears up toward the sideline, and Squirrel White makes a fine catch past the 50.
This offense rolling right now in a nice rhythm. Joe Milton showing off the arm talent, one-on-ones outside. Squirrel Wright has an option on that route. It's going to be a wheel route, but if the DB stays high, he's turning it into a curl.
9 yards, second down and one, and Sampson probes, and he's got a first down. I mean, the tempo when they get humming is incredible. This Tennessee offense, second in the country in time per play, and you can see it from
Kentucky. Yeah, I was just going to say, you wonder how that's affecting Kentucky right now. A lot of guys with hands on hips here in the fourth quarter.
Here's Milton with time to throw. Loads it up. Now climbs in the pocket, and Milton takes off. And he slides down right at the edge of field goal range for Joe Milton on the ground for 7.
Yeah, they were thinking about a post throw down the middle of the field. It was double covered, so good decision by Milton there to tuck it and run.
And now Josiah Hayes is seated against this fast-paced Tennessee offense. Brad White has had to solve that all night long. Hayes is down. We'll step aside with 8:40 to go in the fourth in Lexington.
ESPN College Football Primetime is presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. 18 hotel brands, one loyalty program. Download the app. And in part by Marvel's Spider-Man 2 for PlayStation 5 console. Rated T for teen.
Last day of fall racing at Keeneland here in Lexington. And Josiah Hayes, by the way, right before we went to break, he went down.
And the academy goes to Josiah Hayes, Kentucky.
Now they are supposed to send plays like that to the conference for further action as Hayes went down against this up-tempo attack of Tennessee. Second down and 3, midway through the fourth, and here is Sampson again finding more yards, and he's inside the 30.
He's a beast, man. He just earns all these carries he's getting as the season has gone on. Tough running in between the tackles, finding little creases, getting everything he can.
6.1 a pop for the season for Sampson, who gets enveloped this time on first down.
Yeah, Kentucky's had enough, too. They're starting to drop safeties very close to the line of scrimmage. If you're Joe Milton, this might be an opportunity in a one-on-one, take a shot in the end zone.
On the 10th play of this drive, Milton thinking the same way. Going for the end zone for White, and it's broken up by Phillips.
Well, they moved Andrew Phillips into the slot specifically to cover Squirrel White in this game. Normally, it's Alex Safari, a much bigger body who's good against the run, but that was a good move personnel-wise for Brad White. You see the speed out there, little handsy. He's able to knock it away, and it might have been out of bounds anyway had he even caught it.
That's the most natural position, Brad White told us, for Drew Phillips. He was up to the task, and now it's third down for the Vols here in Lexington. Milton checks it down for Sampson, and again, he's got a first down.
He's so dynamic. There's so many different things they can do, and Kentucky completely forgot and lost him out of the backfield. De'Eriq Jackson decided to try to rush the passer. Sampson ran right by him.
17 yards. Sampson from the 12. Up the middle. Touchdown! He was a beast on that drive.
Big John Campbell's back at left tackle for Tennessee, and that's good news. They're pulling two guys. You've got Castles, the tight end, and there's Campbell coming around. Two bigger bodies at the point of attack. Pin inside, kick outside. There's that tough running again by Sampson. He can go between the tackles, outside, catch the ball. He's earned a role in this offense.
12 plays, 80 yards in not even 3.5 minutes for Tennessee. Charles Campbell is good, and now it's a two-score lead for the Volunteers exactly midway through this fourth. Kentucky's defense stepped up in the third. Tennessee didn't convert on any of its third downs, but this time in the fourth, Dylan. Welcome back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by IHG Hotels and Resorts. Hey, next Saturday, College Football Primetime, presented by Capital One. Top 25 showdown, number 5, Washington, leading right now against USC. Survived Cal earlier today. That's 7:30 p.m. Eastern on ABC.
Caleb Williams versus Michael Penix, sign me up.
Yes, please.
Wow.
And talk about USC.
Survived
today.
Listen, it was almost 3 losses in a row had it not been for some late game heroics.
Touchback. Yeah, let's take a look at our college football rankings brought to you by Verbo.
Well, we saw Oklahoma struggle last week against UCF after the win against Texas, and they go down. And Penn State, they struggled a little bit with Indiana late. Ohio State got their hands full right now with a 7-point lead. But any given weekend, man, you know, it's crazy coming into this week. Outside of Michigan, all the other top 6 teams were playing on the road. You just kind of had the feeling something weird might happen. Everybody's got to bring their A game week in, week out, especially at this juncture of the season.
Kentucky's got it with 7:30 to go in the fourth, trailing by 9, and Leary sets up a screen for Tavion Robinson, fights forward for 8 yards.
Like that idea, and again, just trying to take advantage of having healthy receivers again, just put the football in their hands quickly in space, get some linemen out in front, let them go to work.
Wesley Walker, safety, 5th-year senior, slow to get up for Tennessee.
You know, Tennessee now thinking to themselves, okay, we got to defend the pass. Kamal Haddon, our best DB, done for the season. So they're going to have to be really good on the back end here, anticipating Kentucky and Devin Leary throwing it vertically. They've already thrown for over 300 yards in this game.
Leary's looked as good as he has all season, finally in his 8th game at Kentucky after transferring here to Lexington after 5 years at NC State. On 2nd down, Leary staring down pressure, trying to find Robinson again, but it's incomplete. And now it's 3rd down.
Well, they brought pressure. You said it's staring it down. I mean, he knew that he was going to get absolutely rocked after throwing this football, but he never flinched. Pressure's coming from outside here. That's McDonald. Oof. You say you want to play quarterback. Man.
Leary, a guy who's had a couple devastating injuries in his career. The fibula a few years back, and then the pec last year. He's got 3rd down and 2.
Another blitz look from Tennessee.
They bring 4, and Leary to the sideline, and he's got Dingle for a 1st down.
Dingle's been really good in this game, creating separation. That time they had him matched up in a zone blitz look with a dropping defensive end. It was Roman Harrison that was trying to cover him one-on-one here in the flat. Just a good route, good timing on the throw, outside shoulder, moves the chains.
Jordan Dingle had 7 catches in 7 games coming into tonight. Kentucky's got it from the 41, and Leary checks it down. He's got Ray Davis. And Ray Davis swings forward with a 1st down into plus territory.
And they're another good decision, right? He's trying to go back to Dingle on the stick route. It's not open, so don't freak out and panic or try to force it like we've seen him do a couple times this year. Just find the check down. Go get another first.
Clock ticks towards 6 to go in a 2-score game, and Leary rolls out. Searching and directing, and Leary will just get rid of it as a flag comes in. 2 of them in the secondary.
Tamarian McDonald's in the slot. They're kind of running a smash concept to that side with the guy in the corner out. We'll see up top here. Just kind of hooks the left arm underneath, and man, he almost tackles Tavion Robinson on that play. I like the idea there too, Mike. Liam Cohen moving the pocket, changing the launch point, knowing that Tennessee's now starting to dial up some pressure again, blitzing, and just not making it obvious where Devin Leary's going to be.
Saw those 70 penalty yards, meanwhile, on 9 penalties for Tennessee. showing some pressure again. Instead, it's four. Leary standing in this time and firing across the middle to one of his tight ends, Josh Caddis, who breaks a tackle and tumbles out of bounds into the red zone.
You're just seeing everybody get involved here receiving the ball now. I mean, it's not just receivers, and it's been Dane Key and Brown and Robinson, and we've seen some Jordan Dingle. Now you're getting Josh Caddis on the drag route underneath, doing a nice job trying to stay on his feet. Eight different receivers from UK have caught throws.
He's thrown for 358 back to the air, and Leary incomplete in the direction of Dingle again.
A little more sense of urgency too right now from Kentucky's offense. We saw early in the game huddling, trying to go slow, trying to bleed the clock. All of a sudden though, Devin Leary seems to be in a nice rhythm and a nice tempo, and because of that, they're going faster.
Tense moments in Lexington. 5:42 to go. All three timeouts for Kentucky, trailing by nine. Joe Milton has been excellent on the other side for the Volunteers. Second down, they fake it to Robinson. Set up a screen, and Davis takes it inside the 15. Forward progress there.
Yeah, you know, we saw him scoring on a jet sweep earlier in the game, and there's a fake reverse screen pass to the SEC's leading rusher. Is there another way here Liam Cohen can find a way to get number one involved at a critical juncture?
You said it earlier this half. Keep it in Devin Leary's hands. Liam Cohen went Wildcat on the last possession for the Wildcats, but we'll see what he does here on third down at five. And a flag before the snap. That is costly for Kentucky.
False start, offense, number 77. Five-yard penalty, still third down.
It was just a little flinch by Jeremy Flax, and again, he's been going up against James Pierce all game long, and you know, part of me doesn't blame him. You're just worried about that speed rushing upfield, but in a moment like that, with the game on the line, great position to score a touchdown. Got to hold your water, and that's the third false start on this offensive line.
I mean, you've talked about it, feeling that pressure that you know is coming from Tennessee. So now it's third down and 10 for Kentucky. Pressure comes. Leary gets rid of it to the sideline for Brown at the 10. 2 yards shy, and it's fourth down.
And that is such a small window to fit that football. And Warren Burrell is closing in on it as you see Marcus Cox, the best offensive line at Kentucky, goes down in a very inopportune moment for Kentucky. But just another dime by Devin Leary on this throw. This is incredible. Talk about throwing into small windows here on a speed out. And you can't walk that football to him and put it in a better place.
All right, so you're down by nine now, 4:31 to go. It's a two-score game, fourth down and two. What do you do? Well, the field goal unit's coming.
Yeah, and you have to come away here with points no matter what. At least put yourself in a position to win the game. So this is the right call here by Mark Stoops. Now you need your defense to do their job.
Alex Rayner trying from 53 and missed last time we saw him. This is from 28. Rainer's good to make it a six-point game with 4:24 to go. Kind of knew when these two got together we'd have something like this tonight.
Mexico City Grand Prix starts at 4 p.m. Eastern on ABC with pre-race coverage at 2:30. Ferrari's Charles Leclerc is on pole. It's always a great race, Mike. And I got to tell you, the rain is picking up for what should be a heck of a finish here in Lexington.
Katie George, she came prepared. He's Jesse Palmer. I'm Mike Monaco. Our entire crew behind the scenes in the fourth. 4:24 to go at Kroger Field in Lexington. Tennessee gets the football up by six. after Dylan Sampson was outstanding on the last possession.
You know, technically, Dylan Sampson is third on the depth chart. He would start for a lot of really good programs, though. He's come in, shovel passes, he's bounced off tackles, he's been great in the open field. He's getting a lot of the hard runs. He's finding hard-earned yardage and breaking tackles. You saw him on that last drive up and down the field make plays time and time again, and it's crazy. You consider that Jalen Wright, their starting running back, he's got 120 yards rushing. Yet Dylan Sampson, he's the one in the game.
He's had 14 touches in this game. He had just six last week against Alabama and a loss. Sampson on the ground straight ahead and in that game against Alabama.
And if you're Tennessee, yeah, you think you slow down the tempo a little bit here. And if you're Kentucky, you've got to stop the run here and get it back. But Tennessee's still going fast.
Screen right side, and Sampson slips away. Dylan Sampson does it again.
Part of the reason you're going fast is because that throw right there is basically like a sweep. It's high percentage, but that's a tackle Kentucky had to make behind the line of scrimmage. And again, Sampson somehow able to make the miss. You see Kentucky's all looking to the sideline, trying to get the call. They're not ready. You spit it out with a couple of blockers out in front. Squirrel Wright even missed his guy, but he was not able to make a tackle. It was Andrew Phillips that missed. Sampson's running possessed here late in the game.
No kidding.
This is crazy.
Hey, let's check in with Matt Berry in the studio. All right, Matt, yeah, just absolutely possessed play from Dylan Sampson.
It's incredible. It's just almost an embarrassment of riches. How fortunate are you when you've got Jalen Wright, Jabari Small, Dylan Sampson, guys that could be RB1 for a lot of programs in this country, and you just keep fresh legs in. But the tempo they go at, it makes it so hard on defenses.
I mean, you talk about three guys. Joey Halsley, the offensive coordinator, said to us, I think the reason why, he said, we've had so much success overall with our rushing attack is because we distribute it like this evenly.
Yeah, and these guys all benefit from competing in practice throughout the week. They push each other, and they all show up, and they understand that their touches are going to get limited because they're going to have to share it. But they support each other. They've got each other's backs. And I got to say, they all do a lot of things really, really well. It's not like any of them are just one-dimensional backs. You're lucky as an offense to have one guy.
Yeah.
I mean, Kentucky's got Ray Davis, and he's special. But Tennessee's got three dudes in the backfield.
Jalen Wright has called it the best running back room in the entire country. Hard to argue with that with what we've seen in eight games for Tennessee. Now the question for the Vols, can they finish? Something they didn't do against Alabama.
Something you don't see much. It's kind of a huddle for Tennessee right there. They're just letting the play clock and the game clock bleed down. Anticipating run, they're going to rush to the line of scrimmage, get lined up quickly and snap it.
Soaking precious seconds off the clock.
Kentucky trying to hold on to their three timeouts in case they get the ball back.
Sampson. Left side, finds a seam. Dylan Sampson is cooking in the second half.
Well, Kentucky brought pressure from the slot. It was Andrew Phillips. Unfortunately, a 187-pound DB found Gerald Mincy, who weighs 340, pulling around. This way, this is going to be the collision. The guy coming from this side didn't really have a chance. That's the bread and butter run for Josh Heupel in this offense. Pulling a tackle, Mincy's their best puller. You heard the contact. It's physical downhill runs. This is not a finesse offense. They go fast, they go spread true, but they run the ball and they run it downhill.
That was 24 yards from Sampson. It gets stacked up. They got to grab onto every single limb now of Dylan Sampson.
They do, and they also have to start thinking about when to start using these timeouts. Being judicious about that as well.
Mark Stoops has all three of them, as you said. Clock ticks inside of 2:20 in the fourth.
They're going to run the ball here. If you get a tackle, you got to burn one right away and then come up with a big play on third down.
Where does Tennessee turn? Dylan Sampson has been the guy. They run option. Milton on a pitch. Sampson to the edge and out of bounds right at 2 minutes to go here in the fourth. So now you need that stop here on third down.
Yeah.
clock rolling. Mark Stoops wants an explanation here. And the officials come together. So up to and including 2 minutes to go in the half, it runs when you go out of bounds. And that's exactly when Sampson went out of bounds. So Mark Stoops is granted the timeout after all.
Right. So they stopped the clock at this point. This is kind of a big moment for Tennessee, too, because as of right now, you got a six-point game. Kentucky gets a touchdown, and all of a sudden, they're up. So you kick a field goal here, make it a two-possession game, and you're feeling like you're walking out of Lexington with a win.
You know, guys, Tennessee players told me this week they learned a hard lesson a week ago after playing extremely well in the first half against Alabama. They relaxed and said they paid the price. Joe Milton said we can't get complacent or comfortable at any point of a game. So the focus this week was on the second half. Could they continue to play with urgency and finish? That's what's on the line here. Yeah. Do you grow and learn from a mistake made a week ago?
Yeah, Katie, it's a great point you make. And I think there's two things you got to be happy about. I think if you're Josh Heupel and this coaching staff, one, the way they're finishing this game, and two, how they just handled the environment. We keep talking about how much this team has struggled playing on the road. And they came out here right from the get-go, scoring on their opening drive, taking a lead early. They've been able to keep the pedal to the metal.
Two minutes to go in this border battle. Third down and seven for the Vols from the 37. Keep it on the ground with Milton. To the sideline and a first down, Joe Milton.
Well, we talked about how Joe Milton had to run it a little bit more. Here's a great example of evening out the numbers. This time up front, you've got six blockers and you've got seven, including the running back. So seven against seven. Getting involved at the point of attack. For Joe Milton, there's the speed and the athleticism, able to get the edge and then try to slide in bounds. Keep the clock moving.
Kentucky takes a timeout after Joe Milton with his legs. And Josh Heupel had said to us in the early part of the season he was banged up. We couldn't do as much design run with Joe Milton. Well, the last three games now, they've been able to, and he's got the first down for the Vols. Hey, Tuesday, it's the exclusive reveal of the first college football playoff top 25 rankings. Breeze Davis and the crew will break them down. They'll have coaches' reactions, plus a live interview with Boo Corrigan, the committee chairman. 7 o'clock Eastern, right here on ESPN. I mean, how about the quarterback play, Jesse Palmer, in this? We've talked about Devin Leary. And then Joe Milton has stepped up, and he does it with his legs, trying to secure this for Tennessee.
Who had that on your bingo card, by the way, coming into this one? It was going to be a QB duel between Tennessee and Kentucky, two really good running offenses. But both Joe Milton and Devin Leary really have delivered in big moments with a lot of pressure. They've stepped up, and they've been able to get it done in a lot of different ways. Fitting, really, because of how they've both played, that it's coming down to the wire here.
1:49 to go. Kentucky's got just one timeout, and they swing down. Sampson with De'Aaron Jackson. So Mark Stoops takes that final timeout with 1:38 remaining. So, I mean, these two quarterbacks in this game, they've had up and down moments. They're both transfers in this age of college football where so much is expected right away. And Joe Milton in year three in Knoxville, Devin Leary in his first year in Lexington.
But they continue to work, and they go back to the practice field, and they get into the film room, and they try to apply that here on game day. And they've both been able to do that. I've been impressed with Joe Milton and the accuracy throwing it down the field, which we knew had been a problem really throughout his career. And then for Devin Leary, we hadn't seen this version of him all season long. This looks like the guy in 2021 back at NC State. The reason why a lot of people thought maybe that was the best portal addition from the QB spot that any team got this year. This has been a lot of fun to watch these guys go back and forth. It's come down to which guy has it last.
It's been the second most passing yards for Devin Leary in his entire career. But right now,
It's all about Tennessee. They've got the lead by six, 1:43 to go, and they're trying to grab a road win in the SEC, and that's been elusive recently.
It really has, and so you got to love the energy they came in here with, bouncing back. They were excited to get back on the field after blowing that halftime lead against Alabama.
Second down, they hand it off to Sampson for 2 yards.
This was a big win for them to get too, because even after that loss against Alabama, obviously it's not looking great to go to Atlanta for Tennessee, but still an opportunity to do some really special things this year. Double-digit wins, a New Year's Six bowl game. They've got some big games coming up on the road at Missouri, Georgia obviously on the docket as well, but you had to get past this test. And because of the fact that it was played on the road, that was a big question mark. I like the way Tennessee's responded.
And still trying to get to the finish line here. 1:10 to go on a turning fourth quarter clock. And third down and 9 coming up. And Charles Campbell waiting in the wings, the kicker for Tennessee. Josh Heupel takes his first timeout with 58 seconds to go. And this is the schedule you mentioned.
Yeah, coming up, obviously. And UConn, you expect to be a W. But then this little stretch right here, if you've watched Missouri play, you've seen the weapons they have on offense, you've seen how physical they are on the defensive line, that is going to be a dogfight. And the key there, at, on the road, that's a big question, obviously, for Tennessee. And then, of course, Georgia, which after watching what they did to the Gators today without Brock Bowers, there's a lot of different ways those guys can win games.
What have you made of Carson Beck?
I think he's been outstanding. Statistically, actually, better than Stetson Bennett this time last year. From a tool standpoint, he's got size and arm talent, but they've got so many receivers and tight ends and running backs. They're deep. He seems to get more and more comfortable week in, week out. Really gives the Georgia Bulldogs an advantage. They can win games because of Carson Beck.
Well, that still looms for Tennessee. And here tonight, right now, they've still got 58 seconds left. They've got third down and 9.
I wonder if you're going to see that speed option from Joe Milton. Again, you've seen it a couple times. Got 7 blockers here.
Milton, quarterback power, and he will push a couple of yards forward inside the 25. Ty Bryant, the tackle. Charles Campbell, the kicker, is 4 for 4 in this game.
I think part of why he went QB power there, too, was to keep the ball centered in the middle of the field.
I got a Kentucky player down right near the line of scrimmage. Looks like Keyshawn Silver.
If the injury is the only reason for stopping the clock there, that could be a 10-second runoff for Kentucky, which they could prevent if they had a timeout, but they don't. Under a minute to go, if the injury is the reason why the game clock is stopping, then that's going to be a 10-second runoff.
And both teams barking at one another. That is the always vocal Javontez Spraggins, the right guard, in the middle of it for Tennessee as Silver rises to his feet. So if they run off the 10 seconds, do you even need to run another
play? You don't have to run another play. No, that would bring it down to 34 seconds. Game clock would go. With the play clock at 40, I think that would be ball game.
We said it earlier, Josiah Hayes went down, and you could sense frustration from the Tennessee fans who were here in Lexington. And now, with another guy going down in Keyshawn Silver this time, do they have the 10-second runoff? You can't avoid that because, like you said, Cats are out of timeouts, and then you're inside of the 40-second play clock.
Yeah, I think that's what they're explaining to Mark Stoops right now. Yep, that's it.
Wow.
The defensive injury carries a 10-second subtraction. Time kicker, please set the game clock to 34 seconds. The play clock will be set at 40 and will start on the referee's whistle.
Wow.
Man.
So a 10-second runoff takes us to 34 seconds left. Kentucky heartbreak on one side and Tennessee to the finish line on the other. Wow.
I think you got to be so happy what you've seen from your team if you're Josh Heupel, too, because you did it on the ground like you do mostly every week. And then Joe Milton was really good with accuracy, throwing it through the air. The defense came up and got the stops they needed in key moments. Wins are hard in this conference. This was a big one on the road.
Played this for the 119th time. It ends like this, Katie George.
Coach Heupel, I don't know about you, but that was a really fun game to witness. What did you think of the urgency you saw from your group for all four quarters?
I love the effort and energy that we played with. At the end of the day, winning on the road in this league is really tough. It's a good football team that we played tonight. Proud of the effort from our guys. We've got to play smarter as we continue to go. Got to be better in the red zone offensively, but we'll take it. It's a good win in the league.
Jalen Wright rushes for more than 100. Dylan Sampson completely dominated his scoring drive. What kind of luxury is it to have such a deep running back room?
Yeah, deep room. We got some young guys in there, too. They're really good. They're smart. They're competitive. They run hard. Do a great job of reading what's going on up front. The five bigs were great tonight. Tight ends were awesome. And pass game was good enough. It was a good win.
Congratulations. Enjoy.
Thank you.
He said it at the start. Forks in the road for both these teams.
No doubt.
Tennessee bounces back with a win.
Yeah, up. They've won 36 of their last 39 meetings. This is a big win for them. We talked about some special stuff on the docket for Tennessee if they can keep it going. Kentucky now, three straight losses. They've got to find a way to rebound. You look at the rest of their schedule, not a lot of gimme wins.
Coming up next, college football continues with Oregon State and Arizona. For Katie George, Jesse Palmer, and our entire excellent crew behind the scenes, I'm Mike Monaco saying thanks for joining us. Let's get you back to the studio after a wild one in Lexington. What a finish. Here's Matt Berry.